think, and this applies to poetry and art in general and not just to this particular situation, but I think that it's important to actually look and listen, and that a lot of times we can go on automatic pilot and we just end up saying back what we hear, what the media tells us, you know, speaking in sound bites, whether it's left sound bites or right sound bites, and not really thinking and not really looking. And I think maybe it's an artist's vocation, if we can, to really look at what's in front of us, listen to what's in front of us.
So I'm not both, I'm Ray Armantrout.
Although being both would be interesting.
Let me just open, I am feeling a little thirsty, see if I can open this water. Okay, so, as was said, this is a new and selected, it has about 30 new poems in it, and then it selects from 6 books. And I'm gonna read through it at light, can you hear me okay? At light speed, you know, reading several from the new section and then about one poem from each subsequent book. And then I'll read a few actually new poems, but let me time myself. So I gotta see what time it is. Okay. Okay, this first poem I wrote when I got shortly after getting back from Hong Kong, which, as some of you may know, is an extremely commercial city, but I didn't realize kind of how enclosed a system it was. And then getting back to San Diego, which is kind of anything but, and, you know, a bit funky. Exchange. City of the future, in which each subway station stairs lead to the ground floor of a casino mall. What counts is the role defined for each piece by a system of rules saying how it can move, not the stuff the piece is made of. In the intersection, a muscular, shirtless man with small American flags tied to each wrist so that he looks like a wrestler pushes, no, shoves, then catches a stroller piled high with plastic bags, his stuff. City of the future, where a tramway to the top of a peak opens onto a wax museum in which Michael Jackson extends one gloved hand. That's what's on Victoria Peak. At least it was when I was there. Surplus. I sat on the patio and wrote. Each afternoon, I would sit on the patio where one waggish, unmoored tendril nodded emphatically, and the tree cast a web of nervous yet resilient shadows, while the crickets had no idea what they were insisting on. But then, what's an idea? I might visualize living sculpture, in which subjectivity, unable to either detach itself from the body or direct it, had a public experience of itself as surplus without wishing to harm anyone. In fact, I did. I don't know if you've been to New York City recently, but when I wrote this, I noticed signs on tops of the taxi cabs, and when I was there like 2 weeks ago, those signs were still on the taxi cabs. So this starts with that. Easily. The models in the Gentleman's Club ad are posed with pink mouths slack, eyes narrowed to slits. Show me stunned resentment. the way the world absorbs an insult it won't easily forget. Post-its. And this is kind of an elegy, but to a living person, an imaginary elegy. Before, would my life be like a letter to you then? We never wrote letters. I'm passing the signs we slipped by together. There goes soda and swine. That name is funny because it's a joke we shared about alliteration, right? If I can describe the feeling of your absence precisely, which means using the names of things, buds blacken against blanched light, as ever. St. Didicus's bells ditty reminds us of itself, something old and automated, dividing before from now, again and again, these two, for a moment, still similar. Two, three. Sad fat boy in pirate hat. Long, old, dented, copper-colored Ford. How many traits must a thing have in order to be singular? Echo persuades us everything we say has been said at least once before. Two plump bald men in gray t-shirts and tan shorts are walking a small bulldog, followed by the eyes of an invisible third person. The Trinity was born from what we know of the bitter symbiosis of couples. Can we reduce Echo's sadness by synchronizing our speeches? Is it the beginning or end of real love when we pity a person because in him we see ourselves? This one's kind of light in a way, maybe too light for this particular apocalyptic moment. But anyway, it's about enjoying language. Scumble. What if I were turned on by seemingly innocent words such as scumble, pinky, or extrapolate? What if I maneuvered conversation in the hope that others would pronounce these words? Perhaps the excitement would come from the way the other person touched them lightly and carelessly with his tongue. What if of were such a hot button? Scumble of bushes. What if there were a hidden pleasure in calling one thing by another's name? Pass. Single cells become like-minded, Single cells become like-minded, forming a consensus or quorum. Bioluminescence and virulence are two ways we describe the feeling they share then. With effort, humans can approach this condition. Synchronized swimming has afforded me a wonderful life, says one informant. Why not? I too would like to exert power over time, to pass it aggressively, dramatically, and forget all about it until even the meaning of the word pass gets lost in a rosy glow. Soft money. They're sexy because they're needy, which degrades them. They're sexy because they don't need you. They're sexy because they pretend not to need you, but they're lying, which degrades them.
They're beneath you, and it's hot. They're across the border, rhymes with dancer. They don't need to understand. They're content to be, not mean, which degrades them and is sweet. They want to be the thing in itself and the thing for you. Miss thing, but can't. They want to be you, but can't, which is so hot. Money talks. For sure. Money talks. Money is talking to itself again. In this season's bondage and safari look, its close-out camouflage, hit the refresh button, and this is what you get. Money pretending that its hands are tied. On a billboard by the 880, money admonishes, shut up and play. Head. You just feel wrong, so you convert one neutron to a proton, emit beta radiation. You try not to squirm, to cancel yourself out. Still, in dreams, you narrate each discharge in the first person, as if you were banging your head on every beach in frustration. So now I'm going to go on and read, probably not all these, but some new poems. This one I wrote, it's kind of a prose poem, and I wrote it because I'm often asked to give what's called craft talks, to sort of talk to students about what poetry is or what I think poetry should be. But I'm pretty ambivalent about that. I mean, it's not that I don't have ideas about it. I do have ideas about it, but I'm not sure that I believe my ideas. So I just wrote this in a way that kind of, you know, reveals my disbelief as much as my belief. The craft talk. So that the best thing you could do, it seemed, was climb inside the machine that was language and feel what it wanted or was capable of doing at any point, steering only occasionally. The best thing was to let language speak its piece while standing inside it, not like a knight in armor, exactly, not like a mascot in a chicken suit. The best thing was to create in the reader or listener an uncertainty as to where the voice she heard was coming from, so as to frighten her a little. Why should I want to frighten her? Sometimes I forget. Flicker. When it was them, our parents, dying, the way they tried to deny what was happening, the way they were angry at the wrong things, seemed of a piece with the way they'd always been wrong about us, we thought. The way they were wrong about the world, which they saw only through the haze of their own swath of the past. So that it seemed natural for us to scoff inwardly, even at their deaths. But now it was one of us threatening to get up and walk out of the hospital on his withered legs, sheer sticks, because it was killing him. Clouds of methane rise from dumps outside our city as I drop a square of soft cheese through a slot into the bin marked landfill. Of course, I feel bad about feeling good, about feeling bad about this. But as time speeds up, everything will flicker. And this one has a bit to do with our current election situation, though I wrote it several months ago. Return. Better to collect miniature trolls beside toy bridges and arrange them on doilies. Best we commemorate old fears until our heads are full, lest we trump up some flesh and blood devil. Someone's been walking on your grave. You have seen yourself unexpectedly in a mirrored door. Though some have claimed it's pleasant to leave your body, then return, now you return his gaze. Unquote. Take this cup away from me with its hints of ammonia and dill, oak or corrosion. Who knows, really? What might ammonia taste like to a different person? Roll that question around on your tongue. You've heard it before, or something like it. The familiar is enormous, red-shifted. I'm happy to think of this deep sleep, the sleep of the dead, as a guilty pleasure I am getting away with. This is about sort of about the worst movie in the world, or one of them that I just happened to see out of sheer boredom. Jackpot. Magic's the art of misdirection. No, that's money. Let your children go to the movies, the poet said. But what about this? A troupe of magicians expose bank fraud and universal digital surveillance as the work of one father-son duo, long believed dead, but actually holed up in a casino in Macau. Entertainment's pricey now, but you are worth your weight in cherry hibiscus gummy pandas. With us. With us, it's about choices. How many kinds of kind bar will we want? An abandoned pillow in dry grass says enough, but not too much. It might be a poem. In our thrillers, a protagonist must be convinced that events concern her. Could she be involved? With us, it's about blast radius. Maple pecan is burnt ochre and sand. Arch. Like an arched eyebrow, traveling alone, you drift, seahorse, a forgotten, persistent question. Despite your skeptical attitude, it's true that your numbers are crashing. Still, you are rumored to consume up to 3,000 baby shrimp per day. Who doesn't want to be a revenant, to go back to basics in a big way on the small screen, which somehow still survives? Terrific and terrible are cousins, after all. Am I warm or cold? I'm half rhyming, aiming right between quick and dead, like we could thread that needle and keep going. This poem I wrote in response to a William Carlos Williams poem that irritated me. I mean, I like Williams, but this particular poem of his is called The Widow's Lament in Springtime. And it's a persona poem where he speaks in the voice of the widow who apparently now wants to kill herself because her husband's dead. Anyway, so I sort of went through it line by line and, well, let's just say modernized it. Old Woman's Lament in Autumn. Oh, his starts, Sorrow is My Own Yard. Sorrow is my corner store where jack-o'-lantern balloons get high on the last helium. The end cap is gold today with numbered bags of Werther's originals. No one is Werther. Last night, a newscaster mentioned an elderly victim. Don't call me that. I'm old and obdurate. Pinocchio. I only have three more now, I think. Yeah, three more. I'll read three more. Pinocchio. Strand. String.
In this dream, the paths cross and cross again. They are spelling a real boy out of repetition. Each one is the one real boy. Each knows he must be wrong about this, but he can't feel how. The fish and the fisherman, the pilot, the princess, the fireman, and the ones on fire. Old tricks. For light so loved the light that it kindled what it touched and answered itself wherever it went. Now the lightning strike of the chameleon and the hard eye of the blue-black bug it's swallowing. All tricks of the light, old favorites, new kinks. From a bathtub each night, let crickets sing. And this will be the last one. This is quite new, like within about a week, so I only read it once before ever. And I still don't know really what I think of it, but I'm trying it. Promotion. Then the evening and the morning were the last day. But wasn't I promoted after I named everything? In cartoons, each impulse gets its own signature shape. They foil one another, yet remain intact. Static dressed up as zany or hectic. Here is the fur coat gnawing wears. Point to its pointed teeth. Okay, that's it. So I guess I'm going to sit back there and Fanny's going to read, and then maybe we'll sit up here together and take questions is the idea.
So Ray and I have been friends since 1987 when I moved out to San Diego to teach, and she was in the department there with me. But I don't know when we read together before. But it's hard to remember. So that's great to do. I spent, I don't know how many hours, rethinking what I would read tonight because the landscape of the world kept changing and became very, very dark. And then there would be the normal and children and light and trees, and then you didn't know what had happened to you a few hours before when you had to climb into bed and be sick. So anyway, here we are tonight, and I'm going to read from, I kept changing this. I was going to read about the marathon bombing in 2013 because it was all enmeshed in Cambridge, and the two boys, young men who were the perpetrators, lived a few blocks from here and went to school right up the street, and that haunted me for such a long time, the sense that they were ours, part of this little part of the world, and partly just because of my own fascination or with outsiders committing a crime. I'm sort of with them at some level. I decided that would be just too much tonight to read, so I'm going to read another section from my book, The Needle's Eye. I'll start with a poem called Trainland. And this was written actually on the train leaving Penn Station in New York, and comes out of signs I saw on the way. Is it nothing to you, all who pass by? And Islamic school are scrawled on a wall outside the tunnel. Yellow smog, a dog's broken barking, a bridge of snow on top of flat tenements, and a slash of silver. It's something to see the geese float into a park by the East River. Randall's Island, west of the Bronx, cash and smoke, FedEx. This is what I mean by loneliness. America moving, Rosenzweig Lumber Company, Union Standard, vacated cells, blackened walls, supermarket equipment depot. A boy is listening to women chatting. It comforts him. At the back of Co-op City, a fowl pond, two swans, and more snow. A cherry picker and 1,000 ducks. My cousin, humming Om, is in his closet at home. A call from the Pelhams to the Wailing Wall. I just got out of prison. What do you want me to do, rob for a living? To make it home before the blizzard becomes the point of all this, that never should have happened in the first place. Electric power outlets, a prison, an iron net, fog on the car's glass. We passed through many days in one. 14 times the signs got in the way of the sun. And then I'm going to read a little prose section from the book that is called Like Grown-Ups, because most of the book is about young people and the struggle that they go through to live in this abrasive world. And then I thought I've got to focus a little bit on what it would mean to grow up, to get out through the needle's eye into the responsible world. And I thought about George Oppen, the poet, who was a real grown-up, and a woman named, a philosopher named Simone Weil, who to me also was a real grown-up. And they both went through the world in the 40s, him going into the war and she fleeing France. And she was a great, they never met. But what I love is the fact that they understood each other outside of time. They were writing the same thoughts. They had the same perspective on the world and the war at that time. So it helps me to understand that all these things that go on historically have already been traversed and survived and traversed and survived, mostly through people recognizing each other and each other's thoughts. So this is Like Grown-Ups. Eye of the needle, image of the horizon, destitute metal. The eye singular is also the eye that through the tiny aperture can see the sky. That's from George Oppen. And this is me now. For years I had a friend, a Benedictine monk, who lived a hermetic way of life in California outside his community. It was not always so. The friend began his life in diplomacy and the Foreign Service. In 1945, he was the youngest vice consul in the country and was set to sail to Egypt on a boat out of New York. Before he boarded ship, he went to a secondhand bookstore on the Lower East Side and browsed. In the process, he casually pulled a book off a shelf. It was written by Simone Weil. He took the book away to a restaurant, ordered beef, and sat in a paneled booth, exploring her thoughts as if he were diving into the sea. He said, "What I read was the truth, and I knew that I must devote my life to that, or it would all be meaningless." The substantial part of the story, as he explained to me, was its impossibility. No work of Weil's had been translated into English then. The book was, as it were, a slip in time. It fell out of the future into his hands. He could never find it again. No scholar of her work had ever seen a piece of writing by her that could have landed in a New York bookstore that year, as far as he could tell. Morrissey asked and asked, attempting to explain the mystery. By now, it has become an important part of his story, the story of his religious experience, his understanding of time and prophecy, mysticism, and the hidden life in a world of objective fact. As it turns out, Mary McCarthy translated Vey's great meditation on the Iliad and war in 1945, that same year. It was published in a periodical called Politics under an anagrammatic pseudonym, Emil Novus, that Vey used to hide from the Nazis. This may be why it was so hard to locate. It's important to note that in some way, the hermit was right, even though he was wrong. In 1944, George Oppen sailed by warship into the harbor at Marseille with the 103rd Division. In those days, it would have taken 2 weeks to cross the Atlantic because of the mines planted by the Germans many leagues deep in the sea. The ship would have had to pick its way across the waves. He and Vey missed passing each other on the sea. He arrived in Marseille 2 years after Vey had sailed out of it, heading first to Casablanca, where she was one of 900, mostly Jewish refugees, bundled onto floors. And then she boarded the Serpa Pinto, which docked in New York in July 1942. All the passengers were fleeing the occupation of the Nazis. She was writing an essay on pre-Christian beliefs. She already held the radical position that Hinduism and ancient religious practices were more perfect than the church. She avoided people as usual. On this journey, she had to repeat to herself that being away from France would be temporary and involve her in some vital war effort made from New York. She was a French patriot and resistance fighter. Nonetheless, she said, if we plan to do to the Germans what they did to us, we should be defeated. There are many correspondences between Vey's and Oppen's thoughts, and on the surface, we can identify certain common interests. They shared a commitment to social justice, and both were anti-bourgeois from bourgeois backgrounds. Both engaged with the historical moment in which they lived and let it take root with such a grip that their lives became expiations for the social wrongs being done around them. They felt that one must continually compensate for violence done to others. Both kept notebooks, but Oppen turned his notes into poetry. The other turned hers into essays on a variety of social and metaphysical questions. In his serial poem called Seascape, Needle's Eye, abstract thoughts of his and hers converge: necessity, obedience, decreation, and the mystery of the sea. She sailed from Marseille in the summer and returned to England on a winter ocean, which is when she contracted tuberculosis. She was writing in her notebook all this time and coming closer to an experience of egolessness. She wrote, "The thing we believe to be ourself is as ephemeral and automatic a product of external circumstances as the form of a sea wave." I began these notes on Oppen and Vey in a clabbered seaside house on a rise once called Socialist Hill on Martha's Vineyard. The house belonged to an artist who was a Communist Party member, printmaker for the Federal Art Project of the WPA, and lithographer involved with the Workers' Film and Photo League. As a member of the Artists' Union, she made her greatest work during the 30s. Her house is now circled by SUVs coming from and going to the picturesque fishing village called Menemsha. There are some dress shops and antique stores and takeouts in ramshackle sheds. Inside the house was a tattered collection of books, paintings, and photographs that represented a radical devotion to friendship, manual labor, and the arts. Now in this small wooden house set among five others like it stands the remnant of a neighborhood that was visited by refugees from Europe before and after the war. Trotsky stayed at the home of Max Eastman near this house on his way to Mexico. Trotsky wrote to a friend in 1936 that he had had long discussions with Simone Weil. For a period of time, he wrote, she was more or less in sympathy with our cause, but then she lost faith in the proletariat and in Marxism. For many, the loss of faith in communism was more crushing than the loss of religious belief. The ideologies were alike, and it may have been this troublesome overlap that weakened them both at the center, so they intensified their activities left and right. For Weil, encouraged by her studies of Hinduism and the Greeks, only through the existential renunciation of the ego was it possible to discover a secret value that was sometimes called divine reality. This is what Oppen named the bright light of shipwreck. Oppen, too, was an analyst of the collective, and he, too, hammered away at an impersonal, ethereal, needle's-eye view of the world as seen by a single individual. And he wrote, on the open water, no other way to come here, the outer limit of the ego. Weil sometimes wore a monk's robe, and almost always she kept her body swaddled in cloaks. She was an auto-monastic without an order. She taught girls philosophy, worked in an automobile factory, joined the brigades in the Spanish Civil War. Like a child, she traveled with her parents in Europe, had a mystical encounter with Christ in the Church of St. Francis of Assisi, wrote for politically left newspapers and trade union journals, worked in vineyards in the south of France and for the resistance. Her unsystematic philosophy is rooted in her physical affliction, her blinding migraines, pleurisy, awkwardness, and finally, tuberculosis. Between the ages of 29 and 34, when she died, she was seized by idea after idea of which she scribbled, each of which she scribbled into her notebooks. She never mentioned her health or the weather. In Seascape Needle's Eye, Oppen writes, and here is Weil being directly quoted by him, as if a nail whose wide head were time and space, at the nail's point, the hammer blow undiminished. Oppen was taking notes on his readings of Weil when he was writing his set of poems. In a sense, he was analyzing his own notes as if they were dreams and discovering a surfeit of meaning behind its jotted images, in particular, the needle's eye as he juxtaposed it with the cosmic visions of Plotinus and the unconscious. When Weil spoke of the nail standing in for time and space, she was referring to her migraines, which seemed to be crushed down from the universe and hammered into her brain. She felt in this way the weight of the universe as a great solid substance that we can hold up only by maintaining equilibrium in all our parts. She would see illness as a consent of the body to the invisible presence of the uncreated, and she chose starvation as a way to enter. She lived a solitary life and for a time found happiness in picking grapes and sleeping in a hovel. Appropriately, her great work, her poetic work, was the unworked prose of her notebooks and her essays. War horrified her, but she joined the anti-fascist brigades in Spain. One day, seeing a child deliberately killed by a member of her own brigade, she renounced war for good and returned to a pacifist position. When a child is killed for someone else's idea, the idea is finished. That's it. Thank you. about your Tylenol.
I know, I'm sorry.
So, yeah, we're supposed to see if any of you are curious. Are you curious? Well, I've been on the road in the midst of a book tour, and I have to say that when this book tour was planned, and I knew, you know, that I was going to be reading at Bennington the day after the election, and then with Fanny, which I was looking forward to today, I envisioned a different outcome. You know, I envisioned that Clinton would have been elected, and things would kind of go on as they are. And now, I mean, I haven't written at all, mostly because I've been traveling. But also, it's right now, I'm sure I'll change and get over this, but right now, it feels, just the idea of writing feels weird. I feel like dislocated from my thought. And, you know, when I read my poems that are, I mean, they're serious at the same time that they're funny. I'm not saying that they're light, except for maybe one or two. But when I read a poem and I get a laugh, I feel like, should we be laughing right now? That's my personal response right now. And I don't mean that we can never laugh again or that I'll never write again, but I mean, that's just how I'm feeling.
I'd say it seems that the future seems so strange. It didn't feel strange like a few days ago. Now it has a presence that I don't know or understand. But it helps me, as I was trying to, I guess, say here, was that we've been through great crises. I was born during the Second World War and lived through the awful period of assassinations and the McCarthy period. There have been awful social traumas, even in this very lucky country. So I'm depending on that sense that we recover to go forward, really.
That's true. I mean, in a way, it's always been awful. I think what's weird about Trump and about this moment is he just seems to sort of own it, you know? Like, yeah, everything you thought was bad, that's me. I mean, he doesn't exactly say it that way, but he's not hiding it either. And he still won. Persistent disease, I'm afraid. I don't know if it's a disease of America or of human nature. Probably both.
Yeah, I would say the thing to remember is whatever is happening here now is also happening in England, Western Europe in general, the Middle East. There's some huge trauma that the world is passing around now. It is like a disease that's going around and around. So the fearful thing is, where can you go? Where can you take your children to be safe? And you used to be able to think, I'll go to Fiji or something. Now you can't even think of that, and they get blown up on the beach too. So where, with the drones, with the whole change of landscape, I think it's more that global sense now that's new, that it's everywhere.
And you know, we're not experts on politics, or, I mean, we just are, you know, people reacting, I think. But, well, that's nice. We all have a conscience, I hope. It's hard to be optimistic now, but I'm sure that, you know, there's still hope.
It's the despair about human nature that, for me, is the deepest.
Yeah.
That it doesn't seem to be redeemed at any moment. That's right. I agree.
Okay, anybody else?
Well, Renee sees the flaw in the tiny little things. She sees the magnified vision that we get in the news down in the tiny things. I guess because I grew up in a very politically active family, that it's just part of life. You go out and you talk about it and act. So for me, it was given to me as in childhood with conversation and with my father's activism. So that just seems what you do as a human being, not as a poet or any kind of artist, but as a human being, you get up and go.
I think, and this applies to poetry and art in general and not just to this particular situation, but I think that it's important to actually look and listen, and that a lot of times we can go on automatic pilot and we just end up saying back what we hear, what the media tells us, you know, speaking in sound bites, whether it's left sound bites or right sound bites, and not really thinking and not really looking. And I think maybe it's an artist's vocation, if we can, to really look at what's in front of us, listen to what's in front of us.
But I see that as a carpenter's responsibility.
Yeah, too.
I don't see it.
Hit the nail. Well, really just from what I said, from what I see, maybe from discrepancies, maybe from noticing discrepancies, from noticing, from being puzzled by things. Even this situation, I don't want to just harp on it forever, but I am puzzled about how this happened, why this happened. So maybe I'll write about it eventually, because often I start to write when I'm puzzled. And it doesn't have to be about something bad. Sometimes I'm moved by something. Sometimes I find something extremely beautiful and I don't know why. And it still nags at me. And I write at what nags at me until I understand it a bit better, I guess. So it could be anything, really.
Perplex?
Yes.
Like I would probably be just life itself is my inspiration.
You don't have to have questions.
You don't.
No,
you're free.
You're free. Go forth.